Okay, welcome to the Peripheral Views podcast. We're back with another episode tonight. I'm your host, Jake. Erroll is with me. What's up, Erroll?
Oh, nothing much. You know me, I'm always just hanging in there.
Hanging in. We got a new episode within the film series tonight we're going to pump out. This one's going to be kind of like a low-key, like this is our entrance into the world of independent film, which is we're talking about Napoleon Dynamite today, so that's going to be an interesting talk on behalf of the fact virtue, you know, on behalf mostly of the fact that it is not a like iconic film, but strangely a culturally impactful one, you know, actually had a pretty big, you know, impact on the culture, but we'll get into the details on that. Let's hit the housekeeping stuff. You know where to find us. We're on X at Peripheral View 123. We are on soundcloud.com / peripheral views 123. Throw us in your YouTube search bar, Peripheral Views Podcast. You can find all our content up on YouTube. We are also on the streaming platforms, Apple Podcasts and Spotify. Just throw us in your search bar. You should be able to find us there. And please, if you do, subscribe, rate, and review for us. That's super helpful for our analytics and our development as a podcast. We have a website, peripheralviewspodcast.com. All our content also goes up there along with some other good content related to the podcast. If you want to reach out to us, I haven't been hitting this, but I want to make sure I hit it on this episode because we do still check this. So for any feedback that you would prefer to reach directly to the Peripheral Views Podcast team, feel free to shoot us an email at peripheralviewspodcast@gmail.com. So that pretty much does it for the housekeeping. We appreciate you guys listening and tuning in tonight. Our previous episode, Erroll, what did we talk about in the previous two episodes? They were kind of like co-episodes in a way. We hit the, what was it? The top five MSG sports moments, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then we hit, we did a little, oh yeah, that's right. We did a UFC 295 preview show. And then we pumped out a post show, right after the pay-per-view. And, was there any updates, anything new developments in that domain you wanted to touch on before we move into this episode?
Well, I think Aspinall called for Jon Jones to be stripped of his title.
You're right. He did. Yeah. After that big win last mm-hmm. Saturday.
That's the thing. When you're the big dog, you can just say shit like that, too.
When you've got the strap, too. And he does. I mean, it's kind of I don't know. I think we even mentioned it. I'd just love to see those. Just put those two together. Just let's get Stipe at Stipe, man. Listen, great career. Let's just move on. I want to see Jones.
I don't want to play with you anymore.
I mean, no, I wasn't really all that like keen on that fight. I am curious to see what
it was, because at the moment it was like the battle of like the two quote unquote biggest. But then when you see something like that, you can't ignore it. Yeah, you can't just act like
yeah. I mean, it's like, well, it's, you know, people kept disrespecting Jon Jones, I thought, in a small way. They were like calling the Jones-Stipe fight a legends fight, which it is. They are both legends. So, like, technically it's true, but I also think, like, did people forget that Jones just, like, rolled up in there and, like, literally subbed out the, like, number one heavyweight contender in the world who was, like, 30 years old in, like, 2 minutes?
That was
however
kinda,
long it took him?
That's kind of scary.
That's what I mean. It's like, Legends fight, when people call a fight a Legends fight, it's usually like, oh, Jim Miller's going to fight Clay Guida, and they're both 40, and they haven't fought for a belt, if at all, in 10 years. It's like, that's a Legends fight. Jones is still potentially at the top of the game. You know, I mean, technically he is. He's got the strap, so. Yeah, he did call for – I heard Aspinall call for that, and I don't know that he should have to relinquish. I think that somebody needs to pay Stipe that step aside money, and let's just get Jones and Aspinall together. International Fight Week next year. On that note, I didn't really have anything else on that on that previous episode. So we can just move in right into the content of the day. What do you say?
Oh yeah, I'm ready.
All right, let's do it. So okay, let's first off, we'll kick things off. We're talking Napoleon Dynamite from 2004. We'll get into the details of that film in depth as we move along through the podcast. But first, let's talk about film in the year 2004. So, Errol, where were you at in 2004? That would have made you, what, about 11, 12?
Oh, yeah.
Just a young whippersnapper.
Yeah, I think I was 11 and highly impressionable. And then this thing comes along. Almost shapes my like sense of humor as a... I think so... at that point, like, I haven't necessarily seen anything that was like wildly like just absurd for the sake of like being absurd,
right?
And I think that's why it did so well. Usually when you're like going to watch a movie, you're like, there's gonna be like an actual like problem, and then like it's gonna be overcome. Like, no, this is just like a slice of life. Like, the character, it's like he's not your typical hero. I'll just flat out say that. But for some reason, like, you end up always like voting for him. You're always like I want him to win. You know what I mean? Right, you're like, right. he's kind of different. Like,
he's,
you
like,
know,
he's like a bit of an anti. This was a theme too, and like you know, we'll obviously get into all the details about who, you know, the John Heater character of Napoleon Dynamite. But like, this theme you're talking about was like, it was kind of strewn throughout the this year in comedy, and not just comedies, but just, I think a lot of films were kind of playing this angle a little bit. Like, you think about as I'm kind of looking through the year here, it was a pretty good year for film, and it was a really good year for comedies. And I believe the film that comes to mind for me is, I believe Anchorman came out this year, which is another comedy where like your protagonist is not exactly, he's not like a super likable cat. He's just pumping out just hilarity all the time.
It's almost like, it's like legit, like a, almost like a train wreck. Like, you like can't look away. You're like, yeah, you can't look away.
It's like a car crash.
Right. You're like, how weird does this guy get? How like unapologetically weird does he get? And at every point in the movie, he always just, they're always turning that corner. Like, you're like, man, it's just a guy who knows what he likes. You know what I mean? And like, that stuff isn't necessarily like the popular things, but he's not a cool person, but he makes it seem cool. He's so like confident about himself, like he like doesn't even like acknowledge his faults, if that makes any sense. He's like, they're wrong.
We'll get into that. Let's talk about film in this year before we get into the details of old Nappy D. Because I want to hit it only because it's such an important aspect of like where this film kind of fits in to like the overall, like, you know, the cinema landscape, especially because I will circle to this later because it is like a very important tidbit about the film. Like, this film was really cheap, like really cheaply made, and somehow like, and we'll talk about like the performance and everything in terms of like box office and like DVD sales and all that. But like, we'll get into those details, but I want to lay out the landscape of like film in 2004 first before we go. You know what had a great year in 2004? Ben Stiller was just killing it in 2004. You had, okay, Along Came Polly, which is, have you seen that one? Did that one hit your radar when that came out?
I didn't like see it when it came out, but I've seen it.
It's pretty good. It's pretty funny, right? He does a
lot. Adam Sandler too.
Sandler's always been pretty prolific, but once again, though, this is like the year of comedies. Like, a lot of great comedies this year. But for Ben Stiller, he's got Along Came Polly. He's got Envy with him and Jack Black, which I don't think totally worked. I don't know that, I can't remember really what happens in it, but I don't think it was super well received. Dodgeball comes out this year, another great comedy. He had like a fourth one too. There was another one in there somewhere. But yeah, once again, we mentioned Anchorman.
Soul Plane.
Yeah, we had for comedies. I mean, obviously a lot of big kids movies. Kids movies are always big, really good at the box office. You had Shrek 2. You had Spider-Man 2, The Incredibles. And I don't know. Why don't you give me three films that really stuck out to you that you've seen from that year that like really like hit it for you? That kind of like, I don't know, maybe they represent the year for you in terms of movie going.
Okay. Yeah. Oh, Super Size Me came out then.
Yeah, really influential documentary.
I might throw that on the list.
It's pretty good, man. It's pretty good. Very, very like, kind of shook the culture up a little bit, didn't it?
Right. Yeah. It was. It wasn't even that crazy. White Chicks came out. I didn't necessarily. didn't like love White Chicks.
White Chicks is funny, man. I don't care.
Here's why I don't like White Chicks, because it just enters the uncanny valley. No one immediately knows them. They're like, yeah, no, that tracks. That's them. I'd be like, you guys are crazy. This is like, that's not them. Like, they cut off their face and they're like wearing them. I'm like, that is not. I was like, look at the picture. Like, this is not my best friend.
Well, also, I'm going to hit two.
Harold and Kumar.
Harold and Kumar came out. Wow, this is a great year for comedy. Well, let me hit you with two really quick. So, like, because I feel like you're probably going to name them, and I want dibs. So I'm going to jump out there and hit them, because they're two of my favorite movies of the year easily. Number two would be Team America.
Oh, damn.
Team America is like all time fun. Maybe the all time funniest movie ever made, potentially. But I mean, number one with the bullet is Shaun of the Dead. Shaun of the Dead came out that year too.
Dude, it's a huge, holy huge.
You know what
year.
I mean? Like maybe
Bourne Supremacy, The Grudge.
Yeah, I mean, but if we're just talking comedies, this is a pretty banging year. I mean, this is just.
I mean, if we're talking even everything,
just films, yeah. No,
National Treasure.
Yeah, but I've always looked at the year. It's strange. The year had. It had a lot of very good films, but it didn't have any like all time great films. You know what I mean? It didn't like kind of push the ceiling.
Really up. Good films, but not really great films.
Yeah. I mean, Shaun of the Dead is all time great for sure. But like, I would say other than that, for me, yeah, I don't really see anything that like kind of pushed the ceiling and like really broke through to be like a
considered. I'd say Anchorman.
Anchorman's pretty all time great in terms of comedy for sure. But there's no like, you know, there's no like Godfather-esque, like there's nothing like that truly, you know, truly like left a mark that lasts to this day in terms of like, you know, critical acclaim, we'll call it. But still, I still think it's a pretty solid, I would say this might be one of the best comedy years, in the last two decades, just with those like five or six right there. Man on Fire came out this year, Kill Bill 2. What else you got? I mean, it's a good list of films. Sideways, which is, you know, that's Alexander Payne and Paul Giamatti, which, will, you know, I'll just say right now, the newest film from Alexander Payne, also starring Paul Giamatti, The Holdovers, which was just released in theaters. I was telling you about it. I'm just in love with that film. I mean, it's grown on me like a fine wine. Like it's aging beautifully just in my mind. I've only seen it the one time in theaters, but like, I just can't get it out of my head how like charming it was. It was as great as a year this was for film. It stands alone. It's my favorite film of the year.
Yeah, no, I saw the trailer for that, and I was like, this looks really good.
Yeah, I mean, it's beyond excellent. It's truly it's one of those films that like I feel like you could show it to anyone, truly anyone, and they will enjoy it. Like it's just uncontroversially great, and definitely my favorite movie of the year, ahead of even Killers of the Flower Moon and Oppenheimer and The Killer and all these great. Like it's been a great movie year, and that one truly like kind of jumped out in front for me. But circling back to 2004, yeah. So I mentioned that because the film Sideways also came out that year. That was a huge critical hit. Same filmmaker, same lead actor, Paul Giamatti. Ray, Jamie Foxx, fucking that came out that year. Killing it as Ray Charles. Eternal Sunshine of the Spotless Mind, another great one. Just a pretty solid year. Passion of the Christ. I mean, that was huge, right? That was yikes. Jeez, I mean that made
Tico.
That was purely unintentional, but it works great. I mean, that movie made in the U.S. alone almost $400 million. Worldwide, obviously, made over $500 million. So,
I never seen The Passion.
You never seen it? Yeah, it's tough sit, man. It's tough.
I felt like, so when it came out, like I was like, this seems like a little deep for me to like watch at that age. And then like, I was like, what's it about? They're like, oh, it's just a raw rendition of what happened. I'm like, isn't this, I was like, that's just kind of like self-serving, I guess. I was like, you're just going to show Gizmer without the message?
Nah, it's tasteful. It really is. Believe it or not, it is. It's actually quite beautiful. And like Mel Gibson is like, he's known for doing this because he did it with Apocalypto. I believe it's based on the New Testament, right? Because the Old Testament is Judaism, right? Sorry, my theology needs some brushing up, but either way, he uses the authentic language in the screenplay or whatever. It's written in the authentic, and like all the, or at least most of the dialogue is translated from the like original scripture, the scripture language. So like, and it's beautiful. It's like an actually beautiful film. And obviously like the horrendous brutality of the crucifixion and, everything that led up to it is like very difficult to watch. And it's like very, but it's not what I think it's been described sometimes as being in like kind of like almost theatrically or cinematically violent for the sake of entertainment. I don't get that sense, maybe in some scenes, but I didn't really get that feeling from it. I felt like it was just trying to, if you're going to make the movie, you're going to have to like, that's just going to have to be a part of the story. If that's the movie you're going to make, it's got to be a part of the visual experience. But like, I thought the scenes that surrounded it kind of were pretty respectful. But then Mel, what Mel Gibson was up to on his goddamn cell phone years later. Out there saying some horrendous shit, just absolutely horrible shit. So, but a good film,
right? I would have stopped filming the second that Cross got hit.
Oh, right, yeah, that's like the backstory is that like Caviezel, was like lightning struck the cross, or I don't know if he was on it or if he was like lightning struck like twice on the set. Just like fuck that, man. I'm out. We're shutting down production.
I'd be like, it's not okay. I'd be like, it's not. He said no.
He said no. Yeah, we did not get the approval.
First time, I'd be like, all right, that was kind of crazy. I'm a little two times. Yeah, you probably guys,
You get a little chuckle out of the first time. You're like, whoa, what's going on?
Second time, yeah, you're like, oh, okay.
The second time, it's like, all right, shut it down. Everybody call your agent. We need to collect the insurance on this whole project.
We need to stop filming on Sundays. I told you that.
Oh my god, do you think they did shut down on Sundays? They probably did.
I would have like
Mel's just, they're just like, sir, this is unholy, we've got a fucking schedule to keep.
Meanwhile, unhinged Mel Gibson is just yelling at the sky, I'm doing this for you.
At the sky. A thunderous sky. I'm pretty sure they filmed like in Jordan or something, like like maybe not Jordan but like somewhere. Let's see, where did they film? Yeah, the script and language, they use two old languages without subtitles. We're sitting here doing a breakdown of Passion impromptu. Go us. It was shot in Italy and Rome. It was shot in Italy. I think that's pretty much it, Italy. So, but yeah. It's a good film. It is a good film. And I think people should, give it it'll get a resurgence in appreciation. You know how films do that? They like do that cycle. Like they fall out of favor and then they get like a second life. I think they're making a sequel too, by the way, which is.
We already know how it ends.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Well, we know how the resurrection.
Yeah. Yeah, comes back and he's pissed.
He's coming. Jesus. They should just call it the Passion of the Christ. Revenge. Christ comes back around. Mm. Mel Gibson should not write this, should not make that movie.
No.
Because of the, you know, the, we won't get into the, we're not going to get into any of Mel Gibson's ramblings, but, especially given the state of the world at the moment. But, all right, so let's dive into it. Any other 2004 films you think are worth mentioning here? I think we hit most of them.
Yeah, there's like, it's a bunch sprinkled in here, man.
There's a lot. I mean, it's a good year.
Man on Fire.
Man on Fire is dope as fuck. Have you? When's the last time you've seen that?
A while ago.
Man, that movie kicks ass. I believe I remember, I recall a scene in that film where Denzel Washington, Denzel shoves a bomb up an individual's ass. I'm pretty sure that goes down in that movie, which is, well, that's something. I mean, it's something that happens.
Yeah.
Yes. But anyway, let's move on from, we'll move on from 2004. Oh, Million Dollar Baby. That would be the, that's like, the, that's the movie that won all the awards and shit. And it was the best picture. Have you seen that? Have you seen Million Dollar Baby? It's okay.
I maybe watch it. That's the one where she, the chair, right?
Yeah, just boxing. Spoiler alert. Yeah, chair. Just that's it. Just chair.
Oh,
just
my
say
god,
chair.
Oh my god. In the ring with the chair.
Don't say, don't spoil. We got chastised. We've been critiqued for our spoiler alerts in our commentary section. So
to be fair, we do go spoiler alert. This is what happened.
Anyways, spoiler alert, 3 seconds later. Listen, if you haven't seen Million Dollar Baby at this point, like, man, it's, the movie's like 20 years old.
Well, that's a lot of the, I feel like a lot of the stuff is kind of older.
What is the, you know, what is the statute of limitations on spoiler alerts? Like, I feel like it should be 20 years. 20 years is good. If it's taking you 20 years to see the damn film, I mean, come on now. Are you that itching to see it that much? 20 years is a solid. You can
say, but what if we do a, such a good job talking it up and then we're like, you know,
okay,
they just then, get hit with a steel chair.
Yeah, but you, speaking of chairs. Yeah, I mean, you can't, I guess you can allude. How about that? Allude warning. not like a lewd warning, you know, like anyways, let's move into the content. What are we talking about today? We're talking about, yeah, actually, you know what? We'll do this. We're going to lead in. Let's take a short break. When we come back, we're talking 2004's Napoleon Dynamite.
Fall is here, hear the yell, back to school, ring the bell, brand new shoes, walking blues, climb the fence, books and pens, I can tell that we are gonna be friends, I can tell that we are gonna be friends. Walk with me, Susie Lee, through the park and by the tree, we'll rest upon the ground and look at all the bugs we found. Safely walk to school without a sound. Safely walk to school without a sound. Here we are, no one else. We walk to school all by ourselves. There's dirt on our uniforms from chasing all the ants and worms. We clean up and now it's time to learn. And now it's time to learn. Numbers, letters, learn to spell. Nouns and books and show and tell. Playtime we will throw the ball. Back to class, through the hall. Teacher marks our hide against the wall. Teacher marks our hide against the wall. We don't notice any time pass. We don't notice anything. We sit side by side in every class. Teacher thinks that I sound funny, but she likes the way you sing. Tonight I'll dream while I'm in bed when silly thoughts go through my head about the
bugs. Okay, Napoleon Dynamite, 2004 comedy. Written and directed by the Hess brothers. Jared is their director. Jared Hess and Jerusha Hess. Based on Palooka, which is a, I believe it's a short story. Or, yeah, it's a short film that was directed by Jared Hess from 2002. Produced by Jeremy Kuhn, Chris Wyatt, Sean Covell. Starring John Heder, John Grease, Aaron Ruel, Efren Ramirez, Tina Majorino, Sandy Martin, Diedrich Bader. Cinematography by Mun Powell. Edited by Jeremy Kuhn. Music by John Swihart. Distributed by Fox Searchlight Pictures, Paramount Pictures under MTV Films. Released on January 17th, 2004 at Sundance, and then a wider release and on June 11th, 2004 in the United States. This one I was going to mention earlier, a budget of $400K. So, like, goddamn, they did it cheap. Like, it's as cheap as films can be made.
John Heder got paid $1,000.
That is so crazy. That's literally crazy.
If you ask me, like, in, as far as, like, acting price, like, or being paid for, like, movies goes, it's like it's almost the equivalent of the scene where he's at the chicken farm. Yeah. It's like $1 an hour.
It's like $1 an hour. Yeah. Well, what's crazy is that, okay, so, like, the movie was a huge hit, right? But it wasn't immediate because it did pretty well at the box office, right? So, like, especially on that budget, it made incredible money. It made, like, $46 million.
Dude, all they had to do was, sell a couple tickets.
Yeah.
They made $100,000.
If you can make a film that's going to get picked up by, like, a production company like Paramount or MTV or Fox Searchlight or whatever, you're going to make money on a budget like that. As soon as you get picked up, they knew they were going to make money because it was going to get a wide release. And it was out at, you know, they played it at Sundance. Once you're at Sundance, you already probably knew it too, but, like, the movie was always going to make money, and it did made $46 million. I want to see, before we move too far into the financials performance of the film, let's see how the DVD sales did. Because that's my question is, like, I think this film did better with DVD sales because, okay, yeah. So, like, you're talking about the box office, it probably made about 45, 46 million, it looks like. Let's see what DVD sales look like.
It was, I didn't know this until right now, is voted number 14 on Bravo's 100 Funniest Movies.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Top 15.
That's pretty crazy.
That Dude, is. Top 100 Funniest Movies of all time, top 15 is wild.
Yeah, that's a good spot, and that's on, like, the critical side. But it says here, the numbers.com indicates that okay, it's not going to show financial information, but I want to see video sales. Here we go. So you're talking about probably another. It looks like maybe another 36 million in DVD sales, which is huge, and that makes sense at the time. 2004. That's a big year for DVDs. DVD, I think Blu-ray was coming pretty soon, right? That's on the way. But, like, that's a shit. Put those two numbers together. I mean, that's almost $100 million on a $400,000 budget. That's showing here. I'm seeing another number, another figure from a, let's see, New Americana, indicating 139 million in DVD sales. Maybe that's to this date, which is crazy money. I mean, that's absurd. They made so much money on this film, which is great. It was filmed in Idaho, Franklin County, Idaho, and it's actually beautiful, right? Like, the backdrop is like gorgeous. Like, there's, and, you know, they do an intentional thing, the filmmakers, of, like, there's, it's always filmed with, like, a blue sky. Like, it's always, which it might just be sunny. But, yeah,
I was going to say, so it looks nice, but it looks like that is all there is to it. It looks so damn boring.
Yeah, it looks like nothing going on.
It's so wide and open, literally nothing. It's just sky. Like, it's just.
Does this movie have a little bit of a Mike Judge feel to it? Like, it kind of reminds me of, like, almost like a real life King of Hill.
Yes. I think that slice of life, like, part of it is the reason why it achieved such a cult following, because it's it's really just like a peep into like just some weird backwoods town. Like the characters who I find myself, or at least I found myself relating to most before at the end of the day, you're like, you know what? Like I'm literally Napoleon. Like you see, like you find yourself like, or I found myself identifying with the bullies. I was just laughing at him. They're like, what the heck is he doing? Like, and that's really, that's what we're doing too. We're just like, this guy is weird, but they're just like pushing him into lockers.
Well, I love that. That's one of my favorite scenes is when he's like, he's obviously talking, we were talking about earlier when he's like, I told you I spent with my uncle in Alaska hunting wolverines. And he's like, right. What kind of gun did you use? He's like, freaking 12 gauge. What do you think? And then it just smash cuts to him just getting thrusted into the locker in a headlock.
Has him in a headlock.
He's just getting fucking tossed around. It's fantastic, man. And that is kind of the genius of the movie too. There's just so much. The editing is so good. It's so good. It knows just when to cut and just when to cut to like, to really hammer home like comedic timing. Like it really it nails it.
Here's the thing, like all of these, like all of that kind of subject matter usually is like bullying's not okay, you know what I mean? But like
it works in
Napoleon's
this
he's never he almost he's never like acting like the victim.
No,
he's like,
this is what we were talking. Like, you were kind of trying to jump into it a little bit at the top of the show, and like I only diverted you not because I didn't think it was interesting. I was diverting you just because I wanted us to stay on. I wanted us to hit what we were trying to hit in the opening. But like you were kind of nailing what I was thinking, but almost on the other side of the spectrum. I actually think that Napoleon Dynamite as a character is like extremely unlikable. Like I think he's a fucking dick. Like, he's just a dickhead. He's like kind of likable in that he's like a little bit like. It seems like he's kind of he's trying to divert Kip and Uncle Rico in their little scheme. Like I mean, he's just selfish. Like he's really selfish, and he's also like you can tell he has a moral compass because those two are like up to no good, and he's just kind of pissed at them. But he's only really pissed at them because like. For his own reasons, like because he's got shit that he needs them to help him with because he's still in high school,
right?
It's just
which
like,
is not unreasonable.
No, not totally, but he's also like he's also just a whiny little bitch sometimes. Like his grandma was like, "How was school?" And he's just like, "The worst day of my life. What do you think?"
Well, but like, he gets bullied all the time. Like he doesn't like it. He's like,
"Nah, he's asking for it."
That's the kind. It's you know what it is. It's a. So typically what kids will do is they will conform to like just be a part of the group itself.
He refuses.
Dude, he just doesn't care at all, man. No. He likes what he likes. Yeah. And
He's willing to take a beating for it too.
Whenever he talks about this stuff, like anything, he talks about it like really like candidly. Like he's just like, you know, this is like it's really cool. Like, you know, I really like Ligers stuff. Like he's just
yeah.
I think you don't feel bad for him because he doesn't feel bad for himself.
No, not at all. No, he definitely, that much is absolutely true. He's not like a victim, and it's not a deep character. The film is like, this is why I like this. They don't make movies like this anymore. And it really is kind of a product of like almost like a 90s style indie film because it really is. It's not trying to like scratch at the surface of much really. I don't think the film is about anything necessarily. I don't think the filmmakers were like, man, this like, and they'll probably tell you something different and you could, it's just like philosophy. We've said this before on the podcast that like you can find philosophy anywhere that you're looking for it. But like, with this film, it works if you do want to kind of attach some like, you know, high school coming of age theorizing around it, but it also just works as a purely comedic film where like you don't have to sympathize with the character. And sometimes it actually works better on a comedic level for you not to like, if he's just pathetic enough, you just like most of the time you're laughing at Napoleon, not laughing with him. Right. Until maybe
like
at the dance, even when he's like triumphant in the dance and he's like kind of killing it. At the end, obviously, with that dance sequence, like you're still kind of laughing at him, and then it's as close you get as you get to like doing both, laughing at and laughing with.
Mm-hmm. But that's it's the whole thing. Like he goes out there and he crushes it, but he does that by, you know, once again not conforming. You see that man, and like there's no way you're gonna be like, yeah, he's just gonna bust out some Jamiroquai and actually like, you know, just And so that singular scene convinced me of a universal truth.
Let's hear it.
You could be the absolute best dancer. Like you could, like, you know what I mean? Like you could win a competition against the devil. Like you could, like, be like a trained ballerina that have like danced in like Russian courts. And if you go against a dance battle against someone who is just unapologetically themselves and just breaks it down like that, you yeah. lose.
Yeah.
Like if they're worse at dancing than you, but they just don't care. Like you got served. Like that's,
yeah, it's all about you conviction. About you just got to exactly. be convicted in your moves.
If they're just like, they're just staring you in the soul, just busting it down after you hit them with like the most graceful thing ever, like break dancing, like right. crazy shit. And they still like, okay, I got something for you. And they match you with that. Like that, instant everyone just loses their mind. Like they're just like, nah, like why is he doing that?
You know, yeah, it could be the most ridiculous dance move, but as long as no one's ever seen it before or like
it's, look, just, it's so performed ridiculous with conviction. They're just like, nah, man's is really just hitting it. And if you really are just hitting it, you win.
He was hitting it too, wasn't he? Holy shit, was he hitting it? I mean, it was a well. Let's talk about like the performance. Well, actually, before we do that, I want to circle back to the opening because that opening sequence is really unique. Like you don't see many like this. Like very speaking of low budget. Like I mean, between like the symbolism of like the Salisbury steak and everything, but like. What did you think about like how they decided to do the opening credits with like the each like a fresh, I say fresh, but like a new plate of food and color scheme to like introduce the credit opening?
I thought that was nice. It was very like almost like a Nickelodeon-y.
Yeah, I thought the same thing. Very like childlike. It reminded me of my youth, and it also because they use like so I'll say this. There is a there's a big, what did I say? I said Mike Judge, right? This yeah. movie is the baby of like if Mike Judge and Wes Anderson had a baby.
Oh my god.
I feel like that's the best way to describe it. Like especially the way it looks yeah. and the tone.
That's a really good, really apt description. That's crazy. Where'd you pull that out from?
Well, I said Mike Judge earlier, and then I thought about the opening sequence, and in the opening sequence, like, genuinely feels like Wes Anderson, just in terms of like the music and the way it's like everything's kind of somewhat symmetrical, and it's like in the color schemes, like each time they switch to a new one, they also don't show his name until he pulls his. You notice that they don't show his name until he pulls his binder back on the desk, and his name is like etched into the desk, which is like way later too.
And it's wicked cool because it shows you that he doesn't care about the man.
That's his goddamn desk.
Right. I'm
sorry, go ahead.
I like how like one of the first things he says, like it really does set the tone for like him as a character.
Mm-hmm.
That the kid's like, what are you gonna do today, Napoleon? And he's just like, whatever I feel like, God. And then just chucks an action figure out the window on a string. I was like, that's cool.
That is cool. My daughter Aubrey was watching that and she was just like, she's like, is he gonna let go? And I was like, no, that's the whole point. Isn't that she was like fascinated with his decision making. She was like, her eyes were super wide. She was like, what is he doing?
Dude, whatever like, he feels like.
Yeah.
That's
whatever I feel like, gosh.
And see, that's the thing. That's like he's just like it's the childlike wonder. He never like truly. It's almost like the fact that he didn't have friends like made him more an individual because he didn't have anyone being like, all right, man, that's kind of weird, but like okay. Like he just it was like a like an Ouroboros of awkwardness.
Yeah.
He'd get more awkward because he was awkward and didn't have that much friends, and then he would, you know, further delve into the esoteric stuff he liked, like kung fu and
right, yeah. Well, oh my god, that leads us to Rex Kwando. Well, actually, you know what? That's exactly why I bet you that I came to that Mike Judge thing, right? Because the guy who plays Rex Kwando is it's Diedrich Bader, who's fucking from. He's from all the Mike Judge stuff. He's the Christ. It's gonna kill me. He's the neighbor in Office Space. He's I think he has a couple of voice roles in King of the Hill. I'm almost positive he must. Let's double check. Or maybe not. Wow, he didn't get involved in that, but he's been with Mike Judge a few times. I think he's been.
It makes sense if that's the case, because like he fit right into the vibe there.
Yeah, it was perfect. Maybe I guess he's only been in the Office Space thing. Maybe, wow, I don't know why, but he's like always been linked to Mike Judge in my mind. But I guess for no good reason, because it's really just Office Space. But I definitely remember him in Office Space with the giant handlebar mustache, two chicks at the same time. That guy's great. That guy's fucking hilarious. If you could do anything you want for the rest of your life, what would you do? Two chicks at the same time. This is as good as it gets.
Is that him?
Yeah, that's him. That's the neighbor. That's the dude. Damn. Yeah, he's Rex, bro. What do you think of Rex Kwando? I mean, that scene's fucking hilarious. He's just whacking Kip in the top of the head.
It's perfect because like I like to think of him as like an ex like early UFC fighter. Like, you know what I mean? Like, because this movie's set, like, right around, like, I guess I would say, like, the late 90s or so.
Something like that, probably, yeah.
So, like, right when, like, UFC was, like, getting started, if not even, like, like, you know, like, the 80s-ish when there's just, like, no weight classes. And, like, you had just guys out there with, like, boxing gloves and stuff.
Yeah.
I like to think, like, he technically, like, had his foot in the door there.
But he was a charlatan.
But, like, yeah, just wasn't, like, that good, but technically made it just because, like, there wasn't a lot of people just being like, yeah, I'm willing to fight.
Well, I get the sense that he's some kind of, like, war vet, maybe from, like, the Gulf War or something, because he's, like, he's all decked out in, like, the American flag, and he's got that, he's just got, like, that demeanor of, like, America, like, he's all about America and self-defense. But what did you think of that roundhouse sweep kick from Kip trying to take him out, and he gets whacked in the top of the head?
You know, it's worse.
It wasn't bad. I know, I wasn't expecting it.
It's worse because like the guy's clearly trained to some degree, but is like definitely a hack.
Oh yeah,
he's
for
like,
sure.
He's like, I'll train you to have like, you know, the, he says like,
break the wrist, walk away.
He's like, I'll train you to have the wisdom of a bear. And like, they're like, that's what it says, like in the commercial or something to that degree. And he's like, but it's definitely like all those phony like self defense things. Like the guy's just pointing a gun at him. He's like, yeah, just slap it out of his hands. And then you go into the dojo, and then there's like two fake guns like on the top, and like three knives.
Yeah.
And then, like, the number one rule is respect Rex.
Respect Rex, which is actually, like, the opposite of, like, any other dojo is typically, like, respect yourself and respect your
Yeah, like, respect, like, the sensei. But I guarantee that rule happened just because, like, he had, like, someone actually come in and they're like, dude, this is, like, bullshit. You're gonna respect, no, rule number one, always respect Rex. He's like, rule number two. The rule number two on the board was that never like use Rex Kwando like for to like harm someone or some shit like that. Like, yeah. You need to use it responsibly. So like you come in and you're someone like Kip, and then you see rule number two, you're like, oh yeah, this is the real deal. I'm really gonna learn how to fucking kill someone with my hands.
Well, he's got that one line. He's also just like, last off, my students will learn about self respect. Think anybody thinks I'm a failure because I go home to Starla every night? Forget about it.
you see Starla, and you're like, Wolf.
Yeah, really.
Just like a
body hit him with that builder. Kevin McAllister. Rex, your girlfriend, Wolf. What did you think about? Oh, we got to move into. We got to talk a little Uncle Rico. I mean, probably the funniest scene in the film for me is Uncle Rico hitting that like 60-yard Salisbury steak right to the forehead of Napoleon while he's on the bike.
No, definitely, because it was so unexpected and like out of the frame. Oh, yeah. Too, like he really just yucked a steak at this
guy. He hit him with the submarine style. He takes it right off of Kip's plate too.
He goes, watch this, takes his steak.
And he was eating it too, because they show Kip and he's like struggling with, because he doesn't eat steak, because he's just not about that, right? And he's just got the fork in there with the knife, and he's just trying to cut like the grizzle, and he's barely he's barely actually cutting through. and just failing miserably at eating the Salisbury steak. And he's just I can't remember what his actual line is, but he's like, he starts talking, rattling off his like high school statistics. He doesn't believe him. He's like, I bet you. He's like, I can still do it. I bet you.
And then he
grabs the steak right off his plate. And his
he's sitting there one time. It's probably the quote I say the most, like, from this for no reason. And he's just sitting there looking at, like, the planes, like, just looking at, like, you know, that distant sky we're talking about. He goes, but I could throw a football over the mountain.
But you can throw a football over the mountains.
Like, just looking, like, staring. He's like, yeah. Like, I would just chuck it.
He's just so lost. He's the most delusional man in the world.
Because if Coach would have put me in fourth quarter in that high school game, would have been different. I would have gone pro.
Yeah, remember he was like,
well, he said if they put him in, like, he wasn't even good enough to start in high school. Yeah. Like, no, he wasn't even, like, a starter. Like, they're like, it's a close game. Like, he's a coach, but he's like, shut the hell up. Like, I'm trying to win this game. He's like, if you would have put me in, Coach, it would have been different.
Well, he was also like, remember when he was talking to Napoleon at breakfast or whatever, and he was like telling him, he was like, yeah, she thinks I'm stuck in the past, stuck in 1982. So I kicked her to the curb. And it was like, no, she definitely very obviously kicked you to the curb. His Uncle Rico is very clearly a massive delusional loser.
She was just 100% right too.
Yeah. Yeah. And then I think at one point he literally says, that's the line right there. He's like, back in 82, I used to be able to throw a pigskin a quarter mile. Are you serious? And he's like, I'm dead serious. And he just grabs the steak off his plate and whips it at his forehead. It was not a quarter mile, obviously, too. He throws it like 30 yards at him.
And imagine that. You just chuck a football you chuck a football like four football fields deep.
Like, yeah, it's just impossible. Especially, do you see his form? Like, he's throwing it so bad.
Right, he's like throwing it inside him. There's one time where, because he's always just recording himself. He's always just like record himself, like backing up in the pocket. And there's one time
he's like spinning around the pocket, like in one place. And he's also changing the direction that he would be throwing the football, like. I think one of his like rotations is like he's throwing it one way and then he turns around as though he would throw the football backwards on the play, like he's like facing the opposite direction, like he's going upfield.
Yeah, there's this one time like he backs up and he just like goes to like cock it back and throw it and just loses it, and then he just like shrugs. He's like, oh, what the heck was that about? Like, no one even touches him, or he just loses the football. He's like, oh, whatever.
Yeah, I mean, this guy is just a complete clown show. And definitely a little bit of a dick to Napoleon, too. I can see why. And then, obviously, Kip is just like, what do you think about Kip? I mean, the Kip performance, who is the actor that plays Kip? I mean, have you seen him in anything else ever? Like, in anything?
Yes.
Let's see. He is he was raised a Mormon, apparently. Aaron Ruel. Not really, though. Yeah, he's never been in anything else. That was it. He was in he was in a film called Think Tank. He was in another film called On the Road with Judas. And he was in a television show before Napoleon Dynamite. Oh, wait. Oh, they made an animated Napoleon Dynamite, too. I forgot about that. I was gonna circle to that. It's kind of on my list, but for later in the pod. The character is hilarious, and you can tell it's actually probably influenced. I don't know if it influenced or who influenced what, but Zach Galifianakis's character, his like the guy that he plays in the campaign, or is that what it's called? Campaign. It's like his fake brother. He's like fake, effeminate brother. Who's like from North Carolina. I can't remember what his like fake name for him is, but it's like he's doing like basically the exact same voice. And it is hilarious. It is just hilarious.
It is really funny because they're both on like the opposite sides of the spectrum. Like you can't like as far as being like a popular or like socially not awkward person, like you're kind of like you have an uphill battle when your older brother's Kip. You know what I mean? Like, what do you really expect from him?
They really don't look like brothers either. I don't necessarily buy that they were brothers from the same like parents.
I did. I don't know
why. Napoleon's huge. He's like enormous compared to
him. It made sense to me.
Well, I was going to say that it's interesting. Like, piece of trivia is that John Heder and what's his name? I'm sorry, the actor's name is Efren Ramirez, the guy who plays Pedro. They are actually both they're both identical twins. They both are brothers of identical twins separately.
I was like, are you sure about that?
Yeah.
No, when you were like, you said like they were.
Oh, those two.
That's interesting. I don't know.
Interesting
how
that you would come to that conclusion. No, they have brothers who are identical twins that are, that they're identical to. But I wonder if they use them. Maybe they use them as like body doubles. That would be really smart to you.
That'd be here, so mad.
Why don't I hit you with some while we're on the trivia note? Let's hit a couple. I'll throw out some trivia at you from the film and some interesting factoids about the film. And why don't you kind of like react to them? So like you said, John Heder was paid only $1,000, and the film grossed over 40 million. So obviously that's pretty incredible. For Napoleon's dance routine, director Jared Hess and John Heder improvise and dance to three different songs. Hess then took the best moves from each song and put them in one routine using one song. That's pretty smart. That's a pretty smart way to do it. So that's all improvised then. That's all John Heder's moves. Fuck
dang.
Yeah. The scene of the farmer shooting the cow in front of the school bus full of children is a true anecdote from director Jared Hess's childhood. Yeah, I can imagine that's probably true. Oh, this is a good one. A Napoleon Dynamite Festival was held every year from 2004 to 2008 in Preston, Idaho, the city where the movie was filmed. The festival has had contestants that included a tater tot eating contest, football throwing, lookalikes, and other types of competition based on scenes from the movie. What a sad affair. I mean, my goodness. I want to go there, though. It looks beautiful. Like, I just want to experience it just to see what it feels like to be in a place so like quiet and dull.
Check out the old tetherball.
Oh, he's pretty good. Pretty good at the tetherball. He's got some moves out there. Not bad.
The tater tot. He's speaking of tater tots. That scene is probably like one of the funniest in the movie.
I was saying that's like the most realistic depiction of high school behavior I've ever seen.
Because it's yeah, money. Like it's like money. It's genuine. So you have
because that kid would really ate those tots out of his pocket. Like he right. definitely was. He
so here's. Them. Here's the thing, you see him putting the tots in his pocket, you're like, man, this guy is weird. And then you the guy who's like bullying him, like he looks at it and he's thinking, he's like, yo, that's kind of weird. Then he's like,
I'm hungry. I'm,
he's like, yeah, nah, that's a good idea, man. He's like, yo, let me get one of those. And he's like, yo, like go fuck yourself. Like I fucking push yeah. me into a locker, like I'm starving. I didn't eat these tots. He's like, give me what you just kicks
give me one of your tots.
He just kicks he his smushes him.
Menace. He fucking mushed them all. It's so sick. That's the worst thing you can do.
But he could have, granted, like Napoleon doesn't owe him anything, but I was like, that could have been the olive branch. You could have gave him a tot and then, like, you know, but he's like, nah, get out of here.
No, I feel like didn't you get a sense that those kids, like he wasn't even weirded out that Napoleon had those tots in his pocket. It was almost as though he wasn't even surprised by it. Like they'd known each other since like second grade, and Napoleon's been shoving tots in his pocket the whole time. Like, he was just not surprised by it. He was like, and like it almost seemed as though this is why it felt realistic, because it actually kind of felt like that kid had maybe like he maybe got Napoleon to hook him up with some tots sometime in the past. And that's why he got pissed, because he wouldn't give him any. Give me he's some of your tots.
He's just trying to sneak it in the glass. It's just a close-up of his two fingers going into the pocket, just pulling out a goddamn tater tot.
Yeah, and they're already kind of mushed just from him walking.
he's keeping it perfect.
This kid just fucking hosses him right in the thigh, just mushes him all the bits.
Oh, just crazy. Cold, greasy pocket tots.
Yeah, not even hot anymore, right? Definitely not. Right. Let's do some more trivia. Every dish shown during the opening credits is eaten by a character later in the movie. The dishes presented in the opening credits were the work of the three people who present them. Wow, I did not know that. That's actually pretty interesting. So you'll actually see them eat that dish later in the film.
Technically, Uncle Rico doesn't eat any of the steak. He
throws a steak.
Well, no, he's a vegetarian.
Oh, yeah, but it wasn't...
He chews the steak, but he spits it out. There's actually a scene where you see him spitting out some of the steak.
Oh, yeah, but I'm saying, hold on. Every dish is eaten by not a character. Every dish that's shown is eaten by a character, not eaten by every character. So he's probably just excluded.
Oh, yeah, no, I'm just, he's just a vegetarian as all. So he would chew the steak and then he'd like spit it out.
He was just getting the juice.
All right. That's acting right there.
Yeah, quality.
Conviction.
Despite playing high school students, John Heder and Efren Ramirez were respectively 26 and 31 when this movie was made. You can kind of tell a little bit.
Yeah, like a like emphasis on little. Yeah. Like 26 yeah. and 31.
Their behaviors were pretty on the nose for high school kids though.
Right.
John Heder permed his hair for this film, obviously. John Heder helped to make the boondoggle keychains between scenes. When Kip is on the computer at the beginning of the film, all of the words he is saying were improvised by Aaron Ruel. If listened to closely, one can hear him singing a little bit right as Grandma comes in. That scene's pretty good. Right? That's kind of like how you're introduced to him, too. The scene where Uncle Rico hits Napoleon in the face took 4 takes. That's actually not bad. So he actually obviously did hit him in the face with the steak, but it only took him 4 times to get him.
Dang.
Jack Black almost played Rex. That would have been interesting.
That would have been, I think the movie would have been like legit a classic. If so, nothing against Rex. It's just like if whatever Jack Black puts his name, like, you know.
No, I like that everyone's kind of unknown. They're all unknown actors.
I do too, because it makes it seem more like a small town.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
like it's like an almost like a less of feels a movie, real. Almost like a biopic.
Yeah, it feels genuinely real. I will mention this is funny. We're doing Napoleon Dynamite on the week that Ridley Scott's Napoleon was released. I forgot to mention that at the top of the show, but. This was not intentional. No. Just for listeners, we did not intend to like cross schedule this with the release of Ridley Scott's Napoleon.
Just call this episode Napoleon.
... Dynamite.
No, not even. So people click it and they're like, oh yeah, they reviewed the one thing. I guess they didn't do.
And they find
Killers of the Flower Moon. It's just Napoleon 2004's classic.
I don't know. Are you going to go see that? Are you going to go see Napoleon?
Yeah.
I'd like to. It's pretty long, but I'm not getting the best vibe from the critical response. People are giving that movie a bunch of grief because I guess it's not like purely historically accurate, but like, what do you want from, you know, the filmmakers here? I mean, it's freaking Ridley Scott. He's like 90 years old. He's out there making like 3-hour epic, you know, period pieces. Give the man a break. That's all I'm saying. The Rex Kwon Do code appearing above the mirror in the Rex Kwon Do dojo reads, I shall respect at Rex. I shall never misuse Rex Kwon Do. I shall be a champion of freedom and justice. As you mentioned before.
I think he was a cop.
Yeah, maybe. That actually would make a lot of sense. Throughout the entire film, there isn't a single scene showing any of the characters outside at night.
Hmm.
No nighttime.
You kind of called that.
Yeah, it's all blue skies.
You know what? It makes it seem more wholesome. It's like they really are. It really is like a boring town with nothing. Like there's no one going out late at night sneaking around. It's just whatever happens during the day. That's all you got.
Yep. Regarding the dance scene, Heder was quoted as saying, "When you're shooting an independent film, you don't know what you're going to get the rights to. We thought Jamiroquai." Might be expensive, so we danced to 3 different songs. To that song and another Jamiroquai song, Little L. We danced to Michael Jackson, something off of Off the Wall, just those three. And then we got the rights to Jamiroquai, and I think that was half our budget. So the rights to that song, like, so maybe they made the movie for like even less, $200,000, $250,000. Yeah, I mean, music rights are like very expensive, so that's no surprise. Let's talk critical reception here a little bit. Interestingly enough, the film was like not amazingly received. It is now because I definitely think it's reached like cult classic status, and it definitely had like this amazing run on DVDs. Roger Ebert of the Chicago Times gave the film 1.5 stars, writing that he felt that, quote, the movie makes no attempt to make Napoleon likable and that it contained a kind of studied stupidity that sometimes passes as humor. Eh, give me a break. I couldn't disagree more with that. That's a guy that just doesn't get it. Just doesn't really get it. He didn't get it, and it didn't make him laugh. So therefore, like, he's got to denigrate it as though it's like, I mean, I do agree with the Napoleon likability problem. I don't think it's a problem, though. I actually think it's what makes the film funny.
See, I started off not liking him, but then as it went on, I'm like, he's a product of his environment. He doesn't.
Do you like the delayed kick when after he gets shoved in the locker? Mm-hmm. He's so delayed. Ugh! He just throws that left kick out there and absolutely nothing but air. There was one other tidbit I want to hit. They talked about a sequel, probably not going to happen, especially now that it's 20 years removed. The sequel has been in discussion, but it's very unlikely.
So I was thinking about that. Like, would I even want to see like what Napoleon's up to? Like,
not at this age. No, this is a perfect movie. According to Heater, in January 2023. He stated that he believed the sequel was inevitable and reiterated his interest in displaying a darker tone for the sequel. No, no, no. No way. You can't do that. Just leave well enough alone. I mean, it's just this little piece of like, this stuff never works. You either do it right out of the gate, and that those are always the sequels that tend to, if they're gonna work, this is when they work. Like, you have to do it. There's a short window. You gotta get in there and like make the sequel right after when the kettle's still hot. It doesn't work to take like two decades off and then try to reimagine the magic from the previous film. I just don't think it works that way. But probably going to get a sequel. That sucks.
They're going to make Napoleon Dynamite at night.
Oh, Napoleon Dynamite. They did make the animated series in 2010. It was announced and it came out in 2012 and it was canceled after 6 episodes. Like, especially when you tried that and it didn't work. Just move on, man. Just move on. You hit lightning in a bottle. Just take it. Take it and run with it. You made a boatload of money and it's got like cult status. It's, people watch it all the time. It's on HBO Max. It's all, you can always stream it and people do watch it. So just leave it. Legacy. I thought this was pretty interesting. The term, quote, the Napoleon Dynamite problem has been used to describe the phenomenon where quirky films such as Napoleon Dynamite, Lost in Translation, and I Heart Huckabees prove difficult for researchers to create algorithms that are able to predict whether or not a particular viewer will like the film based on their ratings of previously viewed films. For several years, we already talked about the festival. What do you think about that? Like, we're... researchers can't really pin down who likes this film and who doesn't.
It's polarizing for sure.
It makes sense. It's like, it's kind of, I think it's touching a nerve that's like only within certain types of people. I think,
like, it's definitely like
an all twelve.
Yeah, it's more well received if you kind of feel like you're an outcast.
Right.
Yep. Like, you get to see like the king of outcasts and like he doesn't care, dude. He's having a good time. At least as good as he really can in that hodunk town.
I was going to mention this, like, this just a small comment. It's not anything too drastic or anything, but did you feel like, I don't mean that, I'm not trying to shit on the film. I do like the film. But I did have one small problem with it. I really felt like there's a solid like 15 to 25 minutes in probably I mean, well, admittedly, the first 40 minutes of this film are cooking, right? Like it is cooking. Like I was just dying watching this the other night. The first time I watched this for the pod was the first time I had seen it maybe in 15 years, maybe longer even. It was just crushing me. It was just like, and it was rapid fire. It was like every scene was just smoking me. I was dying.
You did, you learn a little bit more about the universe, and it just gets more and more wild, and then you're just like, yeah, this is exactly why.
Exactly
why he's the way he is.
It's so true. Yeah, you like resonate with him in like a very different like coat of paint. But it was I will say there was like a 15 to 25 minute stretch there after that first 40 minutes where it's just like, it's just nonstop. Every scene, I can't wait for the next scene. And I'm like, every, you get that feeling when you're watching a comedy where a scene will start and you're just like, I know that this scene is going to go somewhere funny and I can't wait to find out where it goes. Right. And that's happening like the first 40 minutes of this film. And then all of a sudden it just takes a giant dip for about 20 minutes. I don't know what happened. Like it's actually a pretty bold move, I think, by the filmmakers, the Hess brothers. I think they decided that they were like, okay, this movie is like a project of ours. It's worth building building the plot out a little bit for a few scenes. So they have like a few scenes there where it's just like him. I think it's like the scene where Pedro's kind of missing. There's like a few of those scenes. It's not to say that they're completely humorless. They're not. There's definitely some moments, but it's not like those first 40 minutes. It kind of really like loses a little bit of steam before picking back up after like the dance.
It's almost like they do an intentional lull and then like for the apex for the dance.
Yeah, I think so too. But I also think they wanted to make sure that like you connected with the storyline, like what's happening in the film, because not much is happening, and that's easy to say. And it's also very easy to forget that anything's happening in the film. Cause like you're sitting there watching it and it's so dry and it's so dull that like, it could take you out of the film. So maybe they just decided that like, okay, we're going to try to build the storyline out a little bit for a chunk of, you know, a small percentage just to build up to this dance scene, which does pay off tremendously.
I didn't even realize he's I missed it. While I was watching it, but he always has like food around him to some degree. Like at the prom, he goes in the bathroom, he like washes his hands, like blows his nose, and then he just pulls out a little baggie, just reaches into it as he's just looking at the mirror eating. And just starts eating like as people are slow dancing to like Forever Young. He's just chomping in the bathroom.
What's with his eyes too? His eyes are like always closed.
Never makes eye contact with anyone.
No, he doesn't.
And if he does, he'll do it for a second and like catch himself and then look down. Even when he asks Pedro, it's so dramatic. For no reason, he's like, and because so those tots, they're Pedro's. He's like, I didn't need anything. He ate his own tots, and then Pedro gave him his. So he's looking at Pedro. He's like, you need your tots? He's like, no, but can I have them? And then like looks down. He's like, yeah. And then just grabs him and stuffs him in his pocket.
Are you drinking 1% because you think you're fat? Well, you're not.
What an opener.
What a great line. It's actually kind of like a nice line. He's being nice. And that was like, that's the other thing too about him, that like, the character is kind of like if he was a true like dork, he would never would have walked up to her, right? Like,
well, that's why he's confident.
He is.
I think that's like kind of what I took from it. I'm like, if this dude can be confident in what he does, like I can, you could like weird stuff and it's okay. Like if he doesn't care, you don't need to care.
Yeah. Good career from John Heater too. I was just looking at his like filmography. He's been in some. He stuck around. He didn't like disappear into like no man's land. You know, like a lot of filmmakers. You know, a lot of like stars films who are like, you know, movies like this where it's lightning in a bottle. It was like his first film. Actually, definitely it was his first film. He made some appearances on Robot Chicken. Nice. He was in The Benchwarmers, which was like a commercial hit but a terrible film. He was a voice in Monster House, which is great, by the way. Have you ever seen Monster House from back in the day?
No.
Oh man, I showed my daughters that, and they are in love with it. It's so good. It's kind of scary. Like, it's actually kind of like, you know, like it'll get you a little bit. It's pretty spooky. But he supplied a voice cast in that. School for Scoundrels, which was like kind of like his first lead role again since this movie. So he got the lead role across from Billy Bob Thornton. Not a good response for that movie. Did not do particularly well. I don't know if it's any good. I've never seen it. Blades of Glory with then now he's across from Will Ferrell, right? So he's in there now. You're talking 2007. He's starring second lead with Will Ferrell, like
after getting $1,000.
After getting $1,000 for this little movie, which Blades of Glory is pretty funny. I don't know if you've seen it. It's pretty funny. It's definitely not like the best piece of It's not the greatest film ever made, very obviously, but it's funny. It's definitely still funny. He pops into My Name is Earl. Let's see. He does. He obviously supplies the Napoleon voice for the animated series. Not a whole lot since then, though. I mean, he's been a lot of TV work, done some shorts, but kind of dissipated a little bit or across time. You know, he's not been in a ton since then. But who knows? You never know. These kinds of actors will always like resurface later in their careers and have a renaissance. Especially when you know they can be funny. Like this dude can definitely be funny.
Right.
So yeah, what else we got, Errol? You got anything else you want to hit, or should we move right into the rating and close it out?
Yeah, no, just like a couple things. Like,
okay.
So I really like, because the whole time, like, you get like that everyone's just kind of posturing, like everyone's just kind of like lying and like,
right,
just building themselves up to be like better than they are, and in the end, like, it ends up being like good for a lot of the people, like in being genuine to themselves. It almost becomes like self-fulfilling. So like in the beginning, like. Kip's like, I've been talking to my girlfriend LaFonda all day. Like, you guys are just jealous, and you're like,
we didn't even talk about LaFonda yet.
Yeah, you're like, Kip, shut the hell up. No, you're not. And then like, he finally like saves up the money, and then like she just comes off the bus, and then they just, dude, they're in love with each other. I'm like, that's fucking.
It's great. It's great.
So he's the only person at the bus stop, and some. Like just rinky dink town, just holding up the LaFonda. She just drops her bags and runs too.
Oh man, it's amazing. It's truly amazing. Yeah, we did not talk about LaFonda. We didn't really talk about the female actors in the film too. You had Hillary Duff's sister is in there. Hayley Duff, she plays Summer, who's kind of mean. Not kind of mean, just straight up mean. Pedro, and she like goes out of her way to write a note to say no. What did you think about the mom being like, you are going to the dance with that boy, Trisha's mom?
I thought that was funny.
That was kind of funny. Did you agree with her? Do you think that's some old school parenting right there?
Well, yeah, no, exactly. Like it was like the business part of it. And then she said it so stern. Like she knew that like Napoleon was like a mess.
Yeah,
and then she was just like, "I don't care, you're gonna do it." And then she just like didn't go to the dance.
She went there and then just totally ditched him.
Yeah, he's like, "I didn't even see her."
That was definitely a moment where you definitely feel like some sympathy for Napoleon, because you were just like, "Oh, that sucks, man. That hurts."
I mean, honestly, I thought I wanted him to go with Summer the whole time.
Really?
Or no? Not
Trisha.
Summer,
but, or not yeah. Trisha. The
yeah.
I'm sorry. Debbie. Yes, Deb. Right.
Jeez. Yeah. But I thought it was just, I was like, it's a win either way. He gets to tell people that he's going with what's her name.
Mm-hmm.
And then, I mean, it kind of sucks for her because, like, it is Napoleon. So I feel for her, but at least he got to say, like, he had a date.
Yeah. Yeah. I thought that's who, like, it seemed like he belonged with was Deb. She was, yeah, she was, and she was really sweet. She was like a sweet, sweet, nice girl. So, yeah, good performance from her too. I thought her acting was pretty good. I think everybody's acting was really good in this. There was nobody who was like, who went too over the top, or, you know, I think everybody kind of nailed it. Just generally speaking. Especially Uncle Rico with that fucking steak throw was just fucking money.
Just to think, like the first thing with the first thing with Deb kids, just like your mom goes to college.
his reaction. There is so much physical comedy in that scene where he's just like, oh, and then he just kind of like turns his head to the side, like so proud of himself. Like,
right,
what is that?
Just oh roasted God. Her.
He was really proud of his performance there. It was fucking great. Anyways, okay, let's do this. Do you have any other like big ones you want to hit, or should we move? We'll take a quick break and go to ratings.
Yeah, I think that sounds fair.
All right, let's do it. We'll be right back, folks. When we come back, we're gonna give our rating and a short review for the 2004 cult classic that is Napoleon Dynamite. We'll be right back. Okay, thanks for hanging in there. Listeners, we've been talking Napoleon Dynamite, 2004, big film, in terms of comedy, in the comedy landscape. It kind of, you know, if any other year, it might have been like the comedy film of the year, but in 04, it had a lot of competition, as we talked about at the top of the show. But we're going to move into it. We've talked the film, we've talked about as much of the film that we can probably get to. Like I said, pretty small budget film, not a huge production. See, you know, there's not a whole lot to talk about, and I think we hit pretty much most of it anyway. So, but a really influential film, a really sweet little film, and just a really, really nice piece of filmmaking out of 2004, out of the independent film, you know, regime of that time. So Errol, why don't you kick us off as per usual? We customarily start with you in terms of the rating and give us a short review. What do you think of the film? And hit us with your rating. I think you're muted.
You thought correctly.
I thought short correct review. As per usual. All right. I swear you do that every time with ratings. Every time. It's like a tradition.
It's the dramatic effect.
Yeah, it's that build. All right, go ahead. What's your give us a short little review of the film? What you thought about the film? What it means to you? And then hit us with a nice rating for it.
Short little review. Yep, it's just a coming of age film about a an awkward teenager and his awkward group of friends, and it's just a you get to watch them grow, and you get to see a little piece of the town, and you know how they're I don't know what year of high school they would have been in. Probably maybe seniors. Yeah, he seems
senior
like
senior or junior, I think.
Yeah,
it's got to be one of the two.
Yeah, so like their latter years of high school, and you know, just I think it's I don't it's weird because I don't want to call it like a feel good movie, but it I think it is. I think
so too. I was just saying during the break that like it's got like when he ends that dance routine and kind of runs off expecting everybody to kind of laugh at him, and then they stand up and applaud him, like that's a definitionally a feel good ending, right? And not that right. That's the very end, but it's close enough to the end of the film that like it feels great.
Just winning the whole thing just from dancing.
Yeah, he won the school over too. Yeah, definitely a feel good movie. I think you're right on that. I think that's true. So hit us. What's your what would you give for a rating? You got to give us a rating out of 10.
I think this movie I can't think of anything that's similar to it. And it's it's such like an iconic piece for me. Like it is it's like both barrels funny. Like it's just all the time just like it's weird because it's not trying that hard, like you know what I mean, but it still
true.
Like accomplishes like so much with so little. I think it's a masterpiece.
Ooh, I'm sensing like a big rating right now. It's like it's like pouring out of you. Just go, just do it, hit it, pull the trigger. Yeah. What are you going?
Yeah, no, this movie is really important to me. This is a 10 out of 10.
Oh my god! Wow! Whoa! Sheesh! Wowza! All right, 10 out of 10 for Errol from the Napoleon Dynamite. God damn, son, you really like this movie? Yeah. Well, listen, you picked this movie. I'm not surprised to hear that. This movie clearly is like very important to you because you did pick it for the podcast. So, 10 out of 10. Okay. I suppose that means it's my turn. I too find the film to be, I wouldn't say it's important to me. I would say that the film, it represents a time in my life. I remember when this film came out, I remember loving it when I was a kid. I was 12 when it came out and I saw it right when it came out. I didn't see it in theaters, but as soon as it was available for like at home rental or DVD, I definitely owned a copy of it. I've definitely seen the film, you know, quite a few times, especially that first, like I said, that first 40 minutes is just cooking. It's just absolute money. Like it is just so funny. Scene after scene after scene is so funny. It does lose me a little bit, about 20 to 25 minutes in. I will also say that I want to give a glowing review of the film, 'cause I actually do think it is like a very special movie, in a lot of ways, 'cause you hit the nail on the head. There's really not a whole lot. There's not many films like it, if any. I would say though that the 20 minutes in the middle where like they're kind of plot building and it kind of just loses the steam of what made it so like funny. Just like it was being funny in these very small little ways. And then it kind of like started maybe trying to do a little too much. I also think, that the film, having not seen it in like over a decade and then rewatching it, it was really funny. I don't know how funny I'd find it on repeat viewings in like short order. Like taking 10 years off and watching it is like perfect, because I feel like I couldn't remember what was going on and what was going to happen next because I just hadn't seen it in so long. So it was like kind of watching it like brand new, which was a great experience. But I do think it might lose me on a second viewing. But it is a special film. It's a cult classic from an era in which comedies were just absolutely firing on all cylinders. It stands the test of time for sure, 'cause it is still funny to this day. Probably by virtue of the fact that it the way it looks and the characters within it kind of exist in their own world at their like a different time and space. But definitely a special film alongside Anchorman and Dodgeball and Along Came Polly and Wedding Crashers and Old School and all these films and 40-Year-Old Virgin, all these like great comedies that came out in that era in that like 2003 to 2005 range were just so, they were just so amazing. And it was just a great time to be, listen, I've said this a million times before, maybe not on the podcast, but definitely to people I know, I always will contend that like people our age, Errol, if you were born in the early 90s, you really got very, very, we got so lucky with our comedies because there was this huge comedy boom at the beginning of the 2000s. And it's like, man, there's nothing more special than being 12 years old, 13 years old, 14 years old, and growing up with films like Old School, Anchorman, Knocked Up, Superbad. Like these movies, these comedies, these raunchy, hilarious comedies were like really special. But then we had films like this, and we had Little Miss Sunshine and Juno, and like there were these indie films, right? That were sweet. Like,
yeah,
and you had Team America and Shaun of the Dead that had like, well, Team America not so much, but Shaun of the Dead definitely had some heart in it, and it was like, it was a strange comedy, but a different beat.
Well, that's the thing too. Like I think Shaun of the Dead is like, technically, like probably the funniest movie.
That's my favorite comedy ever made.
I think it's technically easy. The funniest movie of all time. Like that's that. The only things that really come close to that is like the like Airplane and like,
yeah, Airplane's like, where it's just
like literally everything is a joke.
Every goddamn thing that happens in that movie is a joke. Yeah, I mean, and for that, like, you know, is Napoleon Dynamite that? I don't think so. Not for me. For me, I'll give my rating. For me, it's a 7.5, and I only give it a 7.5. And that's, listen, I'm flipping the switch on you. Like I think I gave The Shining a 9.5 or a 10, and then you gave it a 7.5. I'm like,
is that what this feels like?
You and I are reversing. Yeah, it hurts you. Yeah. It hurts you.
Like damn.
Yeah, because when you gave Shining a 7.5, you hurt me, and now I gotta hurt you back. But it actually is my genuine rating. I had it like in my head before going into the film. And I was like, huh, okay. I remember this being about a 7.58 range for me. And then I watched it and I was like, oh, it was really pleasantly surprised. And I was like, oh shit. It was like the first 40 minutes. I was like, oh, you know, this movie's trending a lot closer to like an 8.5. Like it's like really good. And then you watch it in completion and, it does have a little bit of heart, which is great, but it does just have a few flaws that I think are pretty significant. And, it has some misses too. There's some moments that are not funny that are aiming to be funny. Very few. It's way more funny than it is not funny. But I don't find it. It's not deep, right? It's not a deep film that you think about. It's just a nice watch. It's a nice watch. And there's no shame in a 7.5. 7.5 is a good rating as far as I'm concerned. It's like you're in the upper 25 percentile, like, you know, that upper echelon of rating. And I'm not going to, you know, I'm not going to kind of like, try to justify a 7.5 because I actually think it's a good rating for a good film. As far as I'm concerned, if you're in the 7.5 to 8 range for a film rating from one of us, that's a good film.
Oh yeah.
And by definition, Napoleon Dynamite from 2004, that's a good film. Right?
Yeah.
I mean, it's from my perspective, it's a good film. I would say that that's the best way to describe it. Would you consider it a great film, or is it a 10 out of 10 for you because of how much it means to you?
I think it's more so just like because of like the time I like watched it. I'm like, this is it was like peak comedy for like the longest time to me.
Yeah. Yeah. And it does. It, listen, if it hits you right in the feels at the right time, it can last forever. I mean, that's how I feel about The Thing. Like I saw The Thing. It was like the perfect age. I saw it when I was like a teenager and I was like, what is this? And like, I don't care. That movie's kind of flawed too, but it's just it just gets me, I don't know. It just gives me the warm tinglies. I don't know what it is. Every time it's on, I'm like, hell yeah. I love this goddamn movie. It's speaking to me in the ways it needs to. This one speaks to me it speaks to my funny bone and that's about it. Doesn't like, and a little bit of heart. And I do resonate with the characters to some degree, but like more so, it's just like this movie is effectively funny, and it is good. It's just a good film. Nothing more, nothing less. Are you gonna be able to recover from this pain I've caused you?
I'll manage. I'll get it back. I'll get it back in blood the next time.
Oh, we're gonna do like Shawshank Redemption. You're gonna be like, it's a fucking six.
Right. I was saying earlier, I was like, we're throwing shade if we vote like a six or five. Like that's like,
yeah. I mean, well, listen, we'll do enough films that will probably wind up.
I'm trying to think of something that I'm like, it's just a one.
Like, oh god, there's a lot of those. Like, it's funny because when you watch films like that, what's a film you hate? Is there a film you genuinely hate? You saw it and you're just like, God, I can't. I never want to watch that again. It was terrible.
Yeah, see, like nothing I can think of off the top of my head. There's stuff that I would like prefer not to watch, but like
I never make it through those movies. If I hate it, I usually just like walk away. I'm just like, ugh, this is terrible. You know what I thought was really overrated? I thought was like people really liked it, but I thought was fucking trash was American Hustle.
Oh.
Did you ever see that with Christian Bale? He kind of plays like a fat guy.
No.
It's fucking awful, man. I thought that movie sucked. I just thought it sucked so much. It's like, and I actually made it through the whole movie and I was just like, man, this is a solid 5 out of 10 for me. Maybe even a 4. I just could not get into it. I just thought it was like, I just wasn't buying anything that was being sold to me in that movie, but they're out there and we'll probably talk about some that are bad. Cause what Errol and I try to do for folks listening is we try to select films for one another. I'm up next in terms of the film. We got a big one coming in December, Errol. You know what I'm talking about? Big time. We're going kind of actually going to be talking about it. Here's my hint. I'm going to drop a little, just a small hint just to titillate the listener. We are going to be going back to a filmmaker that we have recently discussed, and we have one of his films on our, in our film catalog. And that's as much as I'll give you for details, but it's coming in December. Keep your eyes peeled for that one. Errol, anything else that you want to talk about Napoleon Dynamite before we move on to what's next in on the pod?
Yeah, no, that's right around it. I just wanted to give it its good graces. There's not, like you were saying, it's not really too deep. There's not really a lot to like break down. I just like the countercultural spin where he's just like, it's like it's almost like he's like an anti cool guy. Like not an anti-hero, but just like, you know what I mean? Like anti-popular. Like
it's extremely like unique character building for sure.
Right.
Yeah.
And it works.
Sure does. Very effective. Very effective. Very funny. Very good film. Like just a solid, solid piece of filmmaking. Glad to cover it. And into the books it goes. So let's talk about what's coming next on the Peripheral Views podcast. What have we got coming up? Errol, we are going to introduce the history series. Errol, what are we talking about when we kick that thing off in the next week or so?
Like the freaking craziest thing anyone's ever done. Like we're going to be talking about a physical feats of like strength and endurance throughout Bingo. History.
Hell yeah. Hell yeah. We're going to talk about, it's basically a historic. So we've been waiting to kick things off in the history series. I believe we actually might've already announced this in the previous pod, but we'll announce it here again. It's our first entry into the history series where we're going to kind of, the history series basically is not going to be, you know, tethered to anything. You know, it doesn't have to be, you know, stereotypically historical. It's just going to be able to, we're going to do we're going to do research that reaches back across history and kind of put things in a historical context, whatever that may be. Could be a historical event, could be, you know, like similar to what we're talking about on this next episode. We're going to be talking about feats of human endurance across history and whatever we can, you know, whatever we can happen to stumble upon in our research,
Yeah, bring up stuff that's like still out now. Like, what is it? Like the Adblair stones or Ardblair? I can't. Those are like big stones that you got to pick up and put on the barrels.
Oh, the World's Strongest Man guys—they're doing that kind of thing. Yeah, yeah. I mean, we'll reach all the way up to 2023 going into 2024 slash we'll go back 2000 years. We'll go back 20,000 years.
If, oh, yeah.
If there's any, the goal is to be, is that we're just going to try to highlight. It's not going to be in any chronological order.
Right.
We're not going to have it. It's not going to have a very strict format, but we're just going to try to touch upon some of the biggest and most impressive feats of human endurance that have ever been reported or chronicled across human history. So
try to end it on like a high note or something. Probably start with like, you know, just like some modern day stuff. Cause as you know, the strong men of today, like stand on the shoulders of like literal giants. So
giants, right.
Right. So like, you know, they're just, they got all those like health, all those like routines and stuff. And like, we know better about like physiology and also like, we like have anabolic steroids.
That helps. Definitely. Right. Juice helps. A lot. That sauce.
So, it's I feel like people are able to like technically accomplish more, but that doesn't take away from like some of the things that people have done. And I think there's some things that we'll bring up that people have done that I don't think that anyone even alive is built for. I don't think they could do it anymore.
No, I've already, you know, the research for both of us has already kind of begun, and there are some really, really interesting, there's going to be some really interesting stories that we're going to cover in relation to this podcast. This is going to be a good one. I'm really excited for this one. I've already started my research on it, as has Errol. So we're going to be in the developing stages of that. I'm thinking probably, what do you think, Errol? Probably next Monday we'll drop that.
If not next Monday, then next like the weekend after.
Yeah. Somewhere in the next 2 weeks, that
might be, might be a little longer because I want to get some nice stuff for this, but I have a couple things in my back pocket.
Yeah. And we've still got another week. So maybe we'll either be ready for it next weekend. If not, keep an eye out within the next 2 weeks for us to drop that one. And then, like I said, we are shifting right into December after that. And we've got a little schedule for December. December's going to be, we're going to probably push pause. I will say this too. We're going to pump them out in December, no doubt, but we will probably be pushing a pause over the holidays. If you guys don't hear from us, which you actually definitely won't now that I'm actually thinking this through here. Happy Thanksgiving, listeners. We really appreciate any support you guys have given us. And we really hope you guys all enjoy your holiday with your families. Great holiday. What do you think about Thanksgiving, Errol? Is that one of your top three holidays over the course of the American year, the calendar year for you?
Yeah, I'd probably say so. It's the most humble, you know.
I love that one. You know what's great about it? It's like, it's all about just peace and eating. Like, what more do you want?
What's there not to like about that?
What's there not to like? Yeah, food and peace. And like, hopefully everybody's household achieves some peace and rest on such a holiday. It
you
is
know
a what?
And
holiday.
Even if you do have a hectic household, sometimes the Thanksgivings are lit when like, you know, when the drama starts happening. So it's like, thankful for this.
You can be thankful for, thankfully that you're alive to experience it, you know? Mm-hmm. Actually, you know, I was going to tell you too, and I'll tell you right here on air. I actually started Blood Meridian in honor of the holiday. Started that thing. Cause it's about it's about indigenous folk. I figured it's like, what better time than any to dive into. It's wild. They like, I'm telling you, that book starts off with a bang. Like it's vicious. Like,
so right. I think I've said it before, on the podcast, but that is, I've heard that, that book is like impossible to, like it'd be impossible to make a movie of.
I think they would have already done it at this point. And it's, I can actually kind of see that. I'm not very far into it. I'm only like two chapters in, but like
not like impossible, but like, it would just be like very distasteful.
I was going to say it's extremely vicious, like right out of the gate. The first, probably within the first, I don't want to spoil anything.
Don't be spoilers.
Spoiler alert for an entire book that I've only read two chapters of. It starts off very vicious. There is like severe violence within the first 20 pages.
Oh, wow.
Like that quick. We kick things off. They give you the lay of the land and they just get right into it. And there's a character that they like introduce really early that's like pretty interesting. Pretty like frightening. We'll say that. It's a great way to put it. But anyways, I'll give a little review of the Blood Meridian you know, once I make it all the way through the book, but I'm pretty excited about it. It's a great book so far. Anyways, so that's Napoleon Dynamite. This has been the Peripheral Views podcast. Thank you guys so much for joining us. We really appreciate all the support and listenership. Keep plugging away with us. We're going to keep developing the podcast outwards and upwards, as we move on. If you're looking for us on socials, hit us on X at Peripheral V123. We are on the streaming platform, soundcloud.com/peripheralviews123. Throw us in the search bar of YouTube, Apple Podcasts, Spotify, at Peripheral Views Podcast. If you do, please subscribe. That's super helpful for the analytics. Even more helpful, hit us with a rating and hit us with a positive review. That's great for our stature on the social media sites. We do have a website, peripheralviews.com. Everything's up there, including this episode. Every episode we do should be up on that website. And if you have any further inquiries that want to reach us more directly, peripheralviewspodcast@gmail.com. That's the place to do it. Send us an email. We do respond expeditiously. So that being said, Erroll, anything else from you?
No. All right.
Happy holidays, folks. Enjoy your Thanksgiving. We'll see you on the next round.